Hi, my name is Dave Mustaine. I'm from Megadeth, and I am going to show you how to play Symphony of Destruction.
I love doing pick scratches. Those are a really unique thing too. Problem is, each of these picks alive. And I found there's the typical ones going down. There's going up, the note changes too. But I got this primarily as a kid listening to Kiss, when Gene would go at the beginning of every single measure probably. One other song has some interesting pick scratching is Bad Omen, and again, playing it upside down. When I go to the second chord here, in that little teeny breathing space, I go, and it's really creepy sounding. So if I play it upside down, I'll go. Make sense? And in other songs, like in Washington's Next, there's one part at the end where I was using a whangmar to make it sound like a wolf going, oh, oh, oh. So I try and make sounds like that. And Skin of My Teeth is another really neat part too, because when the band rebuilds itself with the song in the middle for the tension after the solo, the riff stops. And I just go, just a kind of a, like a man scratching his facial. So there's a lot of interesting things you can do with your pick without you even having to fret the other side of the guitar. Okay, we're gonna show you something right now too, picking chords upside down. And that doesn't make a lot of sense right now, but for me, when you voice a chord upside down and you hear the higher notes first, it obviously is going to sound better because you hear the whole chord. If you hit the lower note first, it's kind of like having a fat person in your house. Ain't much left to do after that note takes over. So I will pick the notes upside down. Does that make sense to you? some of the wider spreading stuff that I do, one of the solos, the very first solo I do every night, I come in and I bar on the 14th fret here, and I'll run the rest of my solo up here, which is... So that whole phrase right there has been barred off, and I'm doing a lot of move instead of going... I'm not able to use the advantage of having these strings ring underneath. So slowly what this solo would look like if you were gonna play it, you're barring and you're going. And it's basically the old Ace Frehley kind of stuff. But again, that solo at speed would be. And one of the most famous spreads that I have is in Holy Wars. I'm doing again the barring and sliding the bar at the end where I'm going. Now, if you listen closely, you can hear all these other notes ringing out. There's the pull off, and then picking the third string. And there's also a weird, if you hear real closely, you can hear the high E resonating in the background right there too. So it's. Can you hear that? And then I just slide it up a fret at a time. Pretty interesting. In Washington's Next, I start off the solo and I'm doing these two fingers here. Typical blockhead chicken pick and pull off, and then I real quickly shift my thumb around. Not very many people notice this when I do it live until it's too late, and then they see it and they're like, oh my god, I can't believe he's doing that. So here's what it looks like slowly. Now if I was going to do this at speed, it would be like this. That. Another one of the really important parts of my playing is the pick that I use. This is a Tortex pick, and it's, I believe, 73 millimeters. And when I hold the pick for me, I was just explaining this to somebody else today too, the shorter that you hold the pick down here, the firmer it's gonna obviously be. So you don't need to have one of those guitar picks that are, you know, like a quarter. I like having a pick that's got some flexibility to it. Now, if I wanna get more response out of it, I'll just loosen up my grip. Or if I want to really get serious, I'll tighten it up and I'll be right on top of that sucker so I can get really fast with pedaling. The difference would be like in Train of Consequences. I'm playing that upside down, of course, so that we don't have to worry about the publisher, but that's holding the pick really loose. Now, if I tighten it up, you get so much more response out of it. I'll do that really slow because I'm not Yngwie. And when it's tight like that, you have less play in the pick. If you look at the chart of the notes, if you're recording on a digital audio workstation, you'll see that they're more consistent when they line up with your grid too. So those are two important things for me with picking. Now, a lot of other guitar players will circle pick. For me, when I started off playing, especially in my previous band, as we developed this entire style, we did a lot of down picking. For example, in Wake Up Dead, I'm gonna have to play it upside down, but it would go like that, right? And if I went, it's so much more noisier, so I down pick. right? Now, a lot of downpicking people can't really do when you get into the really fast stuff. Like, for example, one of the songs that we have is Tornado of Souls. I have to play that upside down again, too. It'd be like... stuff like that, and you're really laying into it. Problem is, if you keep your fingers out, if your fingers are out, it's going to have more things flying around down here. It just makes sense, mass. So I try and pull my fingers in when I'm downpicking like that. I think downpicking is one of the arts that a lot of people have missed, especially if you're clean with it. It requires a lot of concentration. There's a song we have called Gears of War. It's all downpicking. So me playing this upside down is going to sound just like I played it right side up. But the part is just the same thing, downpicking the whole time. And if you do it hard and you're really digging in, you can almost hear the guitar get, you can almost hear the string when the pick hits the string prior to releasing. A lot of guys, when they play, when their pick will cross the guitar strings, pick is going to be turned at an angle like this as it goes across. And it makes a lot of noise because it's actually touching the string before it releases. I try and keep this pick as parallel to the strings as possible, so there's as little contact with the string before the string releases. So those are some of my picking ideas and some of the little things I do to cheat. I actually started playing electric when I was 13, but I wasn't really committed to it. Now, although what I witnessed is, you know, around 15, 16 years old, even though that was the catalyst that had, you know, pretty much rocketed me down the path of pursuing a guitar career, you know, at that age, I was already drinking too. So I was living on my own. Who's going to tell me not to drink? Don't drink, Dave. Yeah, shut up, me. Okay, me. Listen to me. No, don't listen to me. You lose. The reason that I believe I started playing guitar, because, you know, the story's morphed over time. I just kind of liked the way it looked, and it was interesting to me because I was a curious kid, and it made noise. I had a sister who played piano. It was terrible, and I realized better I was a guitar than I could drown out her dreadful noise. And there was a period, too, where I'd gone to some what were called keg parties in Huntington Beach, and would watch backyard bands play, and you would see guys that were pretty much the prototype for Frankenstein, getting very lucky with good-looking girls, and I thought, that's it. I'm skinny, I'm redhead, freckle-faced, not very popular, and that's my ticket. Guitar. Girls. Okay. But see, I didn't realize, like, once you get good at this, that there's so much more be had. There's so much more to offer as a musician. I need to improve on that level as a lead guitar player. I wish I was a better lead guitar player, and I know there's so much fabulous information in your publication. I just don't know how to use it. And that's one of the things I'm really looking forward to yours truly about, you know, us getting together and me learning a little bit more about that, because I can share what I know, but I don't really know what it is that I know, you know what I mean? And as far as becoming more convinced as a lead guitar player is concerned, it was kind of like arm wrestling, you know? You get up on stage and everybody's kicking ass and okay, it's your turn. You know, I think that was one of those things that you can have your little spot in the sun. But I was never one of those guys for the extended guitar solo too. I think when the solo's too long, you should stop it. As good as the Freebird solo is, it's too long. If I ran through the roster of everybody, I would have to say that I looked very fondly on a lot of them, probably more so for leaving, but there's not really any of them that I don't like. I mean, I'm not very fond of a few of them, but they all served a purpose. I couldn't have done it without them. Could have done it better without them, but I couldn't have, you know, somebody else. But who do I miss? Gar was fun. Chris was kind of a schemer. So was Chuck. Jeff was fun but unpredictable. And everybody made fun of him because he was like Bobby Sherman. You know, I remember him calling up FBI when we were in Manhattan and saying, I don't like the water here because he was washing his hair. And he said, I need you to send over 2 bottles of Evian so I can wash my hair. It's still one of the running jokes in the agency in New York about Jeff Young asking to have somebody drive 2 bottles of Evian over to wash his hair. After that was Nick and Marty. And you know, I had good times with Marty. I was mad at him because of the way he left. Not mad at him as a person, just the way he left. Because Megadeth had pretty much turned itself inside out to try to accommodate band harmony. And, you know, we had gotten to a place where I didn't want to be because of trying to be a good leader. And when I had said something to Marty that we need to return to our roots, that's when he went to Japan. And I wish him well. The next two guys that came in after them were kind of just a passing phase, and even though they were good musicians, I really don't think anybody ever embraced them as Megadeth players. You know, they're just nothing, there was really nothing significant that was done by either of those two guys while we were playing together. But, you know, I enjoyed my time with Al. DeGrasso was hard to be around, you know, because he was always busy, so he couldn't get close to him. You know, and I kind of never really felt that band thing because he'd been with so many other players. After a while, you know, if you've been with that many bands, you're no longer a musician, you're a session player. And it's really hard to have a musician vibe with a session player because, you know, as soon as somebody comes up and offers some money, they're going to be gone. And then it takes away the credibility of having a player in your band too because he's played on everybody's stuff. You know, going into the studio with Vinnie Caliuto, I miss Vinnie. Vinnie was fun. You can hear on the outtakes, because when I was kicking his ass on, the system has failed, he throws the drumsticks in and at the end he goes, oh my lord, because, you know, he's not used to going like, I mean, play with Frank Zappa, and he's a shredding player, but he just hadn't played like that. Now, he did the entire record, 3 days, you know, no Pro Tools coming back in and having to fix anything, which was amazing, because every other time we've recorded anything, we've had to go back in there and adjust stuff. James McDonough came in after that. Came and left, you know, there. And the only reason anybody says this name is if someone asks about him. It's kind of like Mark McGuire's name coming up in St. Louis. Nobody says it. See, that's what's weird. When people compare their insides to my outsides, because on the inside, my insides don't match my outsides at all. As far as like when I'm on stage, the game face, no one can touch me. Inside, I'm holding on for dear life because it's a full-on silver bullet out of control. And when I get off of the stage and people say the things that they do, it's really hard for me because I know that it's not my doing. That I was completely gifted with this because I'm self-taught. I still don't really see what the big deal is, you know what I mean? It's like there's so many other guitar players out there that are better than me. I'm sorry, I don't know how to answer that question because I never really was looking for a barometer on my popularity as far as what other people thought. I can tell you that people have said I was difficult my entire career. Ask me a question about people not liking me, I can tell you the first day. As far as like, you know, when I noticed that, I think it's probably pretty strong right now, and it was very strong during the Rust in Peace era. We were in Atlanta. And this is a sad one. We were driving under the overpass by Fulton County Stadium, and the taxi driver was saying, what's the name of y'all's band? So they're making fun of me and saying that I'm a different front man, and he's Robert Plant, we're Led Zeppelin. Oh, he's Stevie Nicks, and we're Fleetwood Mac. That one kind of pissed me off. And I, guy goes, come on, what's the name of your old band? He puts his arm on the back of this. He's staring like this, right? And we say Megadeth. He goes, Megadeth. And right then we go underneath the overpass. It's overcast at the time too, and there's a woman standing in the freeway going like this to us. Now she jumps out of the way, 60 miles an hour, he ran over a person, killed him. And I was never more disgusted with humanity at that moment than when I heard a racist comment come out of the taxi driver. He looked back at me and he said, I hit that sucker right square clean in the head. And then he said, terrible word because he was black. I said, pull over. We all got out on the side of the freeway, and that was it. You know, we were there to get police reports if it was necessary, but I was so freaked out that that guy had just done that and said that. But see, I don't understand that kind of mentality down in the South. I just don't. So that was really bad. Hi, I'm Dave Mustaine from Megadeth, and we're going to be going on a mysterious journey together through the guitar, since I really don't know what I'm doing, but I am going to show you. So write in and tell me what it is I'm playing. One of the things that makes up my sound and my style the most is that I can pick up a guitar that my tech has set up for me, or gone into a studio with an engineer that set up the guitar, the amp, even played my guitar. But it's these right here that make all the difference in the world. The way that I use the flesh of my hands to dampen the strings on this side, the fretting on this side, and a lot of dampening on this side too that people don't really know about. I look at the guitar as a percussive instrument. I think it's really important too that, you know, the guitar can be played melodically or percussively. A lot of times when I'll pick, I will choke the strings off, and then that gives the guitar almost a percussive sound, not so much like a drum, but kind of like one of those stupid wooden fish with a stick that people try and look like they really know what they're doing when they are in a band and they say, play the fish. You pretty much are the loser if you're stuck with the fish. But anyways, for me, the guitar, when you found a comfortable way to hold your guitar, me playing a Flying V, I sit down and let the V's rest against the inside of my leg. I couldn't do this with a lot of other body shapes. Some of them will sit back here on your leg, regardless. When I found my position, it was critical for me where I would put my palm of my hand up and down the string. Some players will let their palm float and they'll deaden their strings in between, with all of the flesh on it. Me, I cheat. I let my little finger hold the pickup ring here. It's this plastic thing around the pickup, and I let the bridge of my hand roll across the saddles on the bridge right here. And what that does is it continues to put down layers of dampening effect. I'll show you an example of this. One of the first songs we start our set with is a song called Sleepwalker, and I'm going to show you a rhythm pattern that's similar to that. It's similar to that. The exact thing I can't play for you right now because of publishing problems and all that kind of stuff. It is my song. I should be able to do what I want, but we don't want to have to confuse anybody out there. So watch the hand again. As I open up my hand, not only does it choke up the string, but it also has a weird sound when the flesh is over the top of the poles and the pickup. Listen again. For me, when I do a lot of chords too, I cheat. I'll do the third, I think that's the fifth and the octave is what that is. I don't really know what I'm doing, so we're taking this journey together. So to me, an E, instead of going, sometimes I'll just fret these two notes right here. And then I can pedal on the root chord. I do that in a lot of songs. Like in Reckoning Day, I'm going to play backwards for you. I'd go. Now, the bass player is doing this note. It fully gives that frequency map of having the bass root, me playing those other two notes, and they stand out better because the frequency map isn't cluttered. Hope that makes sense to you. The technique I'm going to show you next is probably the most popular from was from my previous band, and I can't remember what the name of the song was that they call it, but it was. Whatever the hell that's called. But sliding the chord, and if I just went like this, it's nowhere near as heavy as. And since that's those guys' music, I'll show you where I use it at. But that's where it basically originated when I first tried that. I do that in Ashes in Your Mouth is a good one. And I slide all the way from an E. And I end up in a C, if you can believe that. I think that's what it's called. And then I go over to the G after I do the C. So the whole motion is like this. And that sounds kind of silly, but when you do it at time, it sounds really, really cool. Another song that shows that off a lot is Hook and Mouth, which is a popular song from So Far So Good, So What. And then what I'm basically doing is I'm doing this note. Those three notes. It's a B flat, A, and a G. But I'm sliding up to that, so I'm giving it this really almost groaning kind of sound prior to the chord being voiced. So it sounds like this. I'll do it slowly. And at speed, when you do something like that, it picks up a whole wicked sound of its own. There you go. Hook and Mouth. I like to do a couple of upside down chords. One in particular is in a song called Looking Down the Cross, where we use a lot of these Happy Hollywood chords. This is one. Very spooky, huh? Here's another one. Again, it's... So when I do the chord upside down, what I'm trying to say is I voice the chord with the highest note first so that you can hear the whole chord. It's kind of like if you've got a fat person in your house, there's not really much left after that first note takes over. So what an example is, it would be like this. I'd like to show you now a new technique, which we've been discussing, but in a different song. This song is called Holy Wars, and again, it shows the upside down picking, and also we go back to the two note chords. So some of the chords in Holy Wars are very interesting with the riff in between. Two note chord. Two note chord. Two note chord. And then I do a little riff up here with that same shape. So I'm using the upside down picking pattern and the two note patterns, and it sounds something like this. Ended in a bar chord, because going back from this note to this gives it a whole nother, I would say subtle, but subtle isn't the right word for it. It just kind of lets you know the big dog's back in the house when the power chord comes back in. With my playing, one of the things I really try and do a lot is use the economy of hand space, because when you sing and play at the same time, you're really limited with where you can be looking. You're trying to have dialogue with the audience, and you're also trying to control your instrument. For me, when I play, even if I wasn't singing, I would really like to try and keep what I'm doing as fluid as possible. I see some guitar players I watched Fripp play before, and he did it effortlessly, but for me, I don't have that much time to stare at my guitar, so I try and keep everything close as far as playing is concerned. And one of the chords that I did this with was, I noticed that in a couple of the songs that there was a bar chord, and then there would be another bar chord, one fret up, one string lower, which would be here. And I did this in my previous band, but I'm going to show you the way that I do it in Wake Up Dead. I can't even remember how the way goes with the other guy, so it's probably just as well, but that's a spider chord. Now, when you do that again slowly, you're taking your first and third finger, you put it on the seventh and ninth fret right there, and then your second and fourth would come down on the eighth and tenth fret. So it kind of looks like a mishmash, but when it lands, you don't have the noise going or going. Because if I tried to do Wake Up Dead like that, I'd go, and that's why so many of you are having a hard time with that, because you don't know I'm cheating. Let me show you this at speed. There it is. More of those two note chords too. Definitely the down picking. See, it's all coming together right now. I also use my thumb on other chords. I do that with Reckoning Day at the bottom. When I'm doing the chords here, when I make the modulation, I go up to the G flat, and I'm doing the same thing. But then I anchor my thumb on the second fret there. So check this out. That's the first time, and then I land with my thumb there. And it looks to most people like I'm not fretting the guitar at all, and actually I have. I fretted it at the F sharp there with my thumb. One of the things that I like with guitar playing as far as soloing and stuff is if you really listen to the song, it'll tell you what it needs. When Jimmy Page was sitting there and they asked him what he's doing, he's, I'm waiting for a solo. I mean, that is so brilliant because solos, they're just so important to songs. If you get up there and you do something, you know, like the Beastie Boys Fight for Your Right song, that solo, I don't know who did that, but it just kind of sounds like it was done, you know, for that song by somebody who fit that song. It's like a party solo by, you know, a guitar player. It just kind of sounds like somebody's plinking around. Other songs, when you write a guitar solo, people like David Gilmour, how he can get that much out of what little notes he plays to me is, it's exceptional. It just blows my mind. And so if I was going to tell a guitar player how to actually structure a solo, for me, first thing coming out of the gate is you have to make an explosive beginning. And I do that a lot, like, for example, in Wake Up Dead, I'll grab the fret at the sixth fret, and I'll stretch the string, and I'll pick real fast. And then I bend the string back into position, but that whole thing is just kind of like, oh, okay, here we go. We know something's happening. A lot of the players that I played with over the years have played with a lot of love. I play with hate. I mean, they compare us to fire and ice. Well, I would say so. They like to make their guitars sing. I like to punch it in the stomach. And I think that that's a good thing because somebody's got to take advantage of the guitar. If you're going to play the guitar, you should use every bit of it. And solos for me too, when you get into the higher neck here, if you're stuck in a particular modality, I think that's the right word for it, you really have nowhere to go. So I like to move and continue to climax with the solo going with the uppermost success of the song in mind. For example, with Reckoning Day, it's a song with a wang bar on it, but it's one of those movements from in a position and then it jumps up an octave, and I'll show you. Okay, that's the first measure. I know that sounded kind of stupid, but I'm going to show you exactly why I did that, because I'll do it at speed in a second. And then it repeats it up here. And what that does is it takes the same melody, it establishes a melody with you so that you get familiar with the melody, because it's not a ripping guitar solo. But in order for it to climax, I do the same thing again with a slight, subtle change. So if I was going to play that song at tempo, it'd be... Climaxed. That's a memorable solo too, and it's not like some of these wank fests where, I mean, actually I'm supposed to use a wang bar on that. I don't really do it because I think that most guitars that have wang bars on them aren't used properly by guitar players. They're just not. In conclusion, for me, again, the most important thing is that you're tools are comfortable for you to use. Anybody can hammer a nail, but when you pick up a hammer that's balanced, you don't even notice after you've accomplished a whole day of work and people look at you and they say, job well done. If you have, if you don't have availability to a lot of funds in order to get the right equipment, what I would say is be very careful what you pick for your first guitar, because that'll be the key that opens the door for you with your future and being able to get more equipment. Pick your influences very well. I would make sure that if I'm one of the guys that influence you, I think that you might want to look at some of the people that influenced me too, so you could just cut out the middleman. Find out what made me tick. Picking, super important. Strings, very important too. These strings on my guitar are my signature model. They have a certain tensile to them, so they're, because they're the same gauge, I don't notice anything, but because of the strength of them, the tonality is better. Signature pickups too. Whatever pickups you use, whatever strings you use, make sure it's what you feel the most comfortable with, because a good craftsman never blames his tools. And finally, I'm looking forward to seeing you again. Hopefully by then I'll know more than you. Until then, stay Mustaine, saying see you later.
I used the VMNTs, not this exact one, because I have different colored ones. The different colored ones, because of how old they are, they have different degrees of seasoning with the pickups. The water, the moisture, the sweat from me going inside the pickup rings has changed the way that the pickups sound. So they get broken in over time. And I used the signature cabinets I have that Marshall made for me. They're classic square Marshall cabinets, but it's a new model. It's something we designed together. Speaker cabinet. It's called a 1960 DM. It's my model. We have completely redesigned the whole thing and are using signature Celestion speakers that I designed too. So, I mean, frankly, take my name off it if you don't like it. Just listen to it, because it's one of the best cabinets I made. People that have worked there almost 30 years said it's the best thing that they make. Well, those are a little bit less wattage, so they don't really, you can't really fire them up that much without them wearing down over time. It's definitely got the characteristics of greenbacks, but it's a little bit more consistent than that. You just have to listen to the record. It's on the record. It was a JVM Marshall 410, and like I said, the 1960 DM cabinets. I don't practice.
You don't practice?
Because I get bored doing it. Usually what happens is I'll write something when I start playing, and I'm never ready to record. So my brain tells me, don't pick up the guitar.
Okay.
Because if you're going to write something and you're not going to record it, you're going to get pissed off.
Okay.
And I've done that so many times. I'll start playing something and I'll look around and I'll look for my cell phone so I can call my voicemail and then listen to what I'm doing over the voicemail. And my phone's always away someplace. I have to walk a couple steps. And by the time I come back to the guitar, I have to pick it back up and sit down. I've forgotten what I've done. And, you know, the difference between one note means all the difference in the world, you know. Well, the technique is really, it's based on a lot of things. It's not just the right hand, it's what you're doing. And, you know, I pedal on all different kinds of strings. You're talking back and forth like this. That's either called pedaling or butterfly picking. And I do a lot of down picking, which is the same exact motion as butterfly picking, except you're not picking it on the way back up. So one is down picking like this, and the other is... Well, I can't really show them. You want me to keep playing it, you know, I mean, this is how I play. But the part about the pick, too, when the pick is going perpendicular to the string like this, it makes more noise because when it hits the string before it releases, it's got more time before it plucks it. If it's flat with it and it's parallel to the string, you can hear it. There's a noise there, like, you can almost hear it right before the note. This way, it's just a note. So I try and pick as much as I can, pedaling over the string with the pick parallel to the string like that. And if I mute the string with a little bit of the meat on the outside of my palm here, it makes the string sound better, so it's percussive. If I open it up, that's the same thing. It's the same thing pedaling. You're just sliding your hand up. You can completely deaden it, so it's just percussive, or roll it back a little bit more, it becomes more melodic. Okay, that is, so that part, that's the beginning part. It has a couple different variations of that, and then the verse part is, these are all weird chords. People wouldn't even notice that. Those are all really evil sounding chords. And I didn't do it to try and be like, oh, I'm so evil, you know, because that's stupid. But it was just something that worked. Very end, I go from those weird chords to a power chord because it just has finality to it. So, and what I'm going in this kind of shape, which is basically the same shape as a normal G chord, that's a G. So, when I do this, it's kind of like just moving the G. And then the power chords, and that ends it. And then it's the same thing again. So that's that part. There's other riffs to that song, so I'm not exactly sure. That's all there really is to Holy Wars, except for... That's the progression on that too. So the second part of that song, The Punishment Due, is different. It's... And the way I grab all those chords, it makes all those different sounds. I'm hammering on that and then rolling off. It's really weird. And it gives it way much more sound than going... That's boring, you know? So I go... And I do that over and over again. And they do something that reminds me kind of like of the Beatles. Let me do this right. It's been a while since I played this. I'm doing a C chord there. What would that be up here? That's what the chord would look like if you did it this way. Yeah, I could do that. So that's the other part, and then the very end of it, when it goes. And then it changes back to the funky chord again. And then I do my solo, which I can't show you. Yeah, I do. Like in Reckoning Day, I'll go, remember how it goes. Yes, so I'll use the G on that bar. So it's just an F sharp, and you're just hanging the thumb over the top. The riff part, that song was a song I'd actually written part to on my way home from kickboxing training, and I was thinking I'd written something on a piece of paper. It was a receipt from sushi, because I went to go get some sushi, trying to be Karate Man, eating fish and all that stuff, and I wrote on the back of the receipt, "His metal brain corrodes before the head explodes," and that's all I had for the whole song. And that was the first two lines. There's different ways to do it. There's that way, and then I go, which is a version of the spider chord, or sliding off here. And that just does different stuff. Like there's another technique I started sliding in the chords like that. I did it with the stuff that, some of the stuff I did with Metallica. Like, what was it? I did that. That's my riff. So I came up with that stuff, and I think it's really heavy when you do that. Instead of going like, that's heavier. I don't have a famous scale. They were there before I was here. So I like playing some of the basic, rock and roll scales, which are primarily blues scales, pentatonic scales. I like the chromatic scale. I also like the harmonic minor scales. Playing in major is kind of a little too happy for me. I think that's okay for bands like Bruce Springsteen. They have that kind of, Hungary, this kind of crap, I don't do songs like that, So I have to have songs that explain what my feelings are, and I write music that's a little bit more about what's going on inside of me, and, I'm sorry, I just don't write songs that are like, throwing bouquets of flowers into the water, I'm a guy that sings about, same kind of stuff, but, the different side of the coin. It doesn't make it any worse or any better. It's still the same thing. I have love songs too. It's just my love song, boy meets girl. Girl doesn't like boy. Boy kills girl. It's a typical love story, right? My inspiration comes from all kinds of things. Any given day, there's all kinds of different stuff that happens. Watching the news. I went to dinner the other night, and I was having pizza, and this dad was talking to his daughter. And the daughter was probably around 7 or 8. She looked at me and smiled, and I looked at her, and I'm a dad, so I could tell she was really little. And I'm listening to the dad, and he's going, "Mommy's a liar. Mommy caught daddy. Mommy said daddy got caught watching dirty movies on Netflix, but we know mommy's a liar, right?" And he's saying this to the little girl, and I'm getting madder, and I'm getting madder, and I start to get really fucking mad. And he keeps telling his daughter that his wife's a liar and that he didn't get busted watching porno. And I'm going, psst, psst. I'm trying to get him to look at me so I can go, anything, you know. At this point, I was ready to smash his face in his pizza. And I got up and I just walked out. And when I walked out, I was dripping sweat and I wanted to hurt him so bad for what he was doing, that little kid. That's not right, you know. It ain't my place to tell him what to do, but you know what? Somebody's got to do something about that, you know. And I know when I was a kid and growing up, I didn't have anybody to protect me. I was on my own. So you see stuff like that, that affects you. That influences your day, you know. It ain't all strawberries and orgasms. Sometimes there's bad stuff that you see, you know. And I take the good with the bad, and I hope for the best with people, and I expect the worst, and I'm never disappointed. You know, it's been a long ride. It's been very interesting. I've seen a lot of stuff. I've seen people get run over by cars. I was in a car that ran somebody over, killed him. And the guy didn't even want to stop. He was a taxi driver in Atlanta, and he called him the N-word after he killed him. He wasn't even going to stop. That's not right.
What's up? Welcome to Spread TV, and I'm Dave Navarro, and that's Todd Newman, of course. And this is a very special, special day for us because we have with us in the studio Mr. Dave Mustaine of Megadeth. And I can't tell you how excited Todd and I are about this. Since we started the show, you were like one of the first guys. We're like, we got to get Mustaine.
Absolutely.
We got to get Mustaine. So thank you so much for
coming down. You're welcome.
So what's cooking right now with the band? You guys are on tour right now?
We're actually in between legs. We just got back from going to India, of all places.
Wow.
And it was really interesting. Leaving, I was in the airport, and I saw a guy that was purple.
Yeah.
He looked like a Kalamata olive.
Yeah, it was just phenomenal.
And I was looking at the dude, and I looked down, and he was wearing sandals, and his feet were absolutely purple, and I was like, this has got to be really hardcore to go through life looking like Barney. So.
Yeah. India.
Yeah, wow. We played in Bangalore, and it was an outdoor festival with Machine Head and a bunch of other satanic bands and stuff.
Is there any kind of, because like India is like real serious, like hardcore, their religion is like, what is it, like Hindu there? Is
that it's Hindi, and also there's some Muslim people out there, but I think it's pretty much a melting pot of a lot of different religions. I think because it's in Asia, there's so many different type of people that cut through India, you know.
But it's surprising because I've never played there. I've never been there. Mm-hmm. But it's surprising that there's a market for like the satanic realm.
Oh, yeah. The funny thing was the audience, there was a lot of people out there that were digging on the whole black metal vibe. And I'm not into that myself, but it was really interesting. You know, you come in and it's a country that's suffering from poverty really bad. But, you know, you go to where the hotels are, where the artists stay at, and you would think it was like Newport Beach or something like that, you know.
Great.
And then you get in your car and you drive about 30 inches off of the sidewalk and you're in the middle of traffic and you realize that you're basically in the middle of a third world country.
I know. It's wild. Had you been there before?
Mm-mm. No. And the coolest thing was, as soon as we got there, we had a Mahavishnu warrior, I think is what was called, Mahavishnu or something, and he had this huge sign on his head that he was balancing, and he was doing push-ups with this thing on his head, and he'd stand up and dance and everything, and this one guy had a sword, and he's like sticking his tongue out at me. I'm like, just keep the sword where I can see it, you know.
Yeah.
He handed me a coconut, and it was like a peace offering, and I didn't know if I wanted to drink it or not, because, you know, you just...
But it could be some kind of huge insult if you didn't. Did you drink it?
I took a little bit of it.
Yeah, you got it.
You know, I didn't know if it was like some kind of, you know, I've seen that one Chevy Chase movie where the guy gets the toxic stuff and the last thing I want to do is explode on stage.
Maybe having a sip of that is why that guy appeared purple to you later.
Perhaps.
You think about it.
Yeah.
So that's awesome. So you guys are taking a break now. You're going out. I'm really curious to know what your take on the whole music industry right now is. And you're one of the lucky ones because Megadeth has always had like a serious hardcore following, you know, but things right now are so fucked up for up and coming bands, new bands. Do you have a a feeling about that or a thought about
that?
Do I
have a feeling about it? Well, I think that the music industry's obviously changed, because when I started, music business was all one word. It was music business. Now it's music, which is us, and business, which is the record company people. And most of the people that work at the record companies, they don't have any talent as far as like playing instruments, so they get into music business. And before, at least the guys that worked at the record companies, you know, they had some kind of talent. You know, it's like in the live entertainment business now, there used to be promoters. Now they're just talent buyers. Yeah. The years of Bill Graham are gone.
I know.
With the digital audio workstations, anybody and their brother can make a song and cut and paste and turn it into a whole ripping song. But then, you know, you get on stage and there's only so long a guy can stare down at his feet before people say, I want my money back.
That's what I think.
I'm going years with, I think we went almost 10 years having releases with no guitar solos on them. And for me, that's because the guitar players weren't good enough to do solos.
Yeah.
You know, they tune their guitar to it. It's a percussive instrument, and then they just don't take any risks or explore the guitar.
Yeah, yeah. Well, we're pretty psyched to have you here for that reason as well, because as a guitar player, you know, we kind of actually came up around the same time, like the late 80s and the 90s, back when I, you know, there's a guy named Ron Lafitte that I guess he used to work with management, and he managed us at the same time. And incidentally, and I don't know if you want to get into this, but he's the same guy who put me into rehab for the first time, and I believe you as well, is that correct?
He caused me to go to rehab.
Yeah. Difference. A little bit of a difference there. Touche. Yeah. Did you get it? Was it an intervention? Because I was like intervened on.
Well, I mean, as much as you can intervene somebody who doesn't want to go, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, it was very in vogue to have the sobriety police in the 90s, you know, with a certain band from Boston going around with, you know, telling everybody that they can or can't drink and they can or cannot get loaded and stuff. And I mean, you know, if you can get loaded and you can handle yourself, then who are you harming?
Yeah,
except
yourself. And that's where I'm at. Like, I'm sober, but like, if people can deal and handle it, great. The funny thing about Ron was that he used to dangle you in front of me. Well, like Mustaine's going, you know, he, you know, if he can do it, you know, you can. That's part of the reason I ended up going in. And as a result, I went like, probably in like 15 of those things.
I'm sorry.
No,
you were of service without even knowing.
Yeah, it's all good.
I don't know. I like the word dangle.
Well, you know what I'm saying. He was like, you know, if Mustaine can go, you can go. And, you know, and it was,
part of the reason I went is because I knew they had drugs there.
Yeah, yeah. And it's like a 30-day, you know, it's a 30-day vacation. They get you high. You know, I ended up going quite a few times. But
Yeah, me too. I developed a $30,000 a month treatment center habit.
Yeah. So moving back into the music thing, you know, we talked a little bit on the phone, and one of the things I brought up, and I, you know, anybody out there that wants to hear like Metallica stories and all that shit, I'm going to spare us, because like we, you know, just go on the internet and look at that. But as far as like your appearance in the Some Kind of Monster documentary, and we both watched that, we were just so impressed with like your level of honesty and directness in that. And I don't know, you kind of, to us, like, came out as the fucking, as the cool one. Do you know what I'm saying? And what, you know, because if we're not talking about, like, recovery and all that stuff, what did it take to get to that level of clarity?
With them?
With you and with them, you know what I mean?
Well, like, the funny thing is that whole thing that went down, that was September 13th. And September 11th, our country had been attacked.
Yeah.
So that was 2 days after we got nailed. And that was my 40th birthday. And I'm spending my 40th birthday with Lars.
Now, that's
a terrible joke.
Yeah.
When we sat down to talk, he said, do you mind if this counselor sits here and helps us work through this? And I thought, sure, you don't have any idea how much counseling I had to go through.
Yeah.
Because of you guys.
Yeah.
And so we talked a little bit, and I knew that the guy that was working with them, there was something that just was unsettling about him I didn't like. So
the guy in the sweaters.
Phil Towle is his name.
Yes.
You know, they called him the connector, and I thought, well, it was more like the account drainer. And, you know, I don't understand why you would want to have all your, you know, I mean, watching the Osbournes and having their dogs crap in their house on the floor, that to me is just mind-boggling how you would want someone to see something like that,
right.
Let alone have somebody see the inner turmoil of your band. I mean, the one thing that's for sure is that... people see the dynamics of that group and
yeah.
and how hard it was to be in there. I mean, Jason went through it too.
Oh yeah.
You know, I mean, I know all bands have those kind of problems. You've been in a couple of
bands
that have been very exploding personalities.
I think that's one of the reasons why that resonated with me so much when I saw you just being direct and saying, you know, that's not what I said. What I said was this, you mm-hmm. know, because.
Well, I'm not afraid of Lars. Everybody else is.
Yeah, but so. I mean, you know, what's to be afraid of if you're just speaking honestly? Mm-hmm. But like the reason I identified with it is because, you know, I spent some time in the Chili Peppers, and because mm-hmm. of my drug addiction, was ejected from that situation, mm-hmm. and they went on to like, you know, sell multi-platinum selling records, mm-hmm. and it was, you know, yeah, there was a lot to struggle with that, mm-hmm. and then certainly my experience in Jane's addiction and my relationship with Perry there's always been an animosity there, mm-hmm. you know, and like what really shone through for me is like not only did you have like the clarity to have that conversation, but how much other people don't, mm-hmm. like how difficult that is for people to just speak openly and honestly mm-hmm. about something that's fucking 20 years old. You know what I mean?
Well, I don't talk about it. I usually end up refuting it because people keep bringing it up. You know, I mean, if it wasn't good in a certain way for me to acknowledge that whole thing, I probably wouldn't talk about it. I mean, there's two great bands out of the whole thing, and it was just not meant to be. James and I had planned on firing Lars so many times, and Lars he won't ever cop to this, but he was getting canned when... The guys were coming back from the European tour before Cliff died. They planned on getting rid of him, you know? I mean, I wish them the best of luck. I think that the world knows now. I mean, I like James more than Lars. I think everybody does. I have no problems with James, you know? Yeah. Don't really like Kirk because he got my job, but, you know, I nailed his girlfriend before I left, so.
Whoa! Snap! Hey, what are you gonna do? Going back to Megadeth and where you're at now and your career there, you know, when you stepped into the lead singer role, this is one thing I wanted to ask you because I put out a solo record years ago where I went into the singing role. Mm-hmm. That transition for you, like when I did it, I realized why singers are fucking crazy. Do you know what I'm saying? because there's just so much, you know, intensity on you. Because being a guitar player for 15 years, mm-hmm. and I had my instrument, and it didn't matter what I, you know, how my voice felt or my physical condition, I could play. Once I stepped into that role, it was a whole nother world of mm-hmm. insanity.
Yeah.
You know, and because I used to let my guitar speak for me. Now it's my actual words. Mm-hmm. You know, what was that transition like for you?
Well, I didn't start singing until after we'd auditioned a lot of guys, and we were actually the last straw came. It was I think it was December of 82, I think it was, and we'd had some guy named Billy Bonds of all names come in, and he had 2 12 packs of Budweiser. Now we were homeless at the time, so free beer for me was almost as good as free sex.
Billy Bonds, you're in.
So the guy shows up and he had eyeliner on and mascara and stuff. I can tell. For some guys it's okay, you know, depending on their bands or their background, right. But for Megadeth it just wasn't right. You know, so we drank all his beer and fired him, and and then that next time we rehearsed, Ellison had said something, why don't you just try singing? And I thought, why don't you? And I tried it, and it was hard because I didn't know how to do the circular breathing and everything.
Right.
And I still don't consider myself a singer. I'm more like a vocalist. And as far as like...
You mean you're a distinct personality vocally, which is, you know, a lot of people can sing, but they don't have a distinct... Like you hear them and you're like, that's Dave.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I didn't mean to interrupt you, but...
No, that's okay.
That's how we look at you. We were just listening to Megadeth on the way over here, and we were like, dude, this guy's way better than Hetfield.
We actually were.
We were. Because there's an attitude.
And you wonder why it continues.
I'm just saying.
Fueling the fire.
Yeah, but I'm just saying, there's an irony and a smirk is what you said.
There's a
smirk.
Sarcasm and an attitude in the voice that's like, you can't learn how to sing that. Mm-hmm. It just comes out that way, and that's mm-hmm. why... I've been a fan since day one anyway.
Thanks.
The one thing that I wanted to actually ask is, have you had pressure to try and conform to any newer kinds of music, like from labels and stuff like that? Because the one thing that I love is Megadeth's been Megadeth all the way through. When you hear some of these other bands, you know, they're one thing in the 80s or another thing in the 90s or another thing in the millennium. Is there been pressure to do that and you're just like, fuck you, this is what we do? Or
well, yeah, there was definitely pressure. When Countdown to Extinction came out, it was number two in America. And Billy Ray Cyrus had the number one record with Achy Breaky Heart. And it was a novelty, so you couldn't shake it. And consequently, I hate him, and his, my daughter watches his daughter's show, and mm-hmm. I get to see him there with his supercut hairdo, and it just blows my mind, you know, that you can see somebody go on to superstardom like that, obviously riding the back of his daughter, but when we had the next, not literally.
Not short on opinions, this guy, by the way.
Not literally. and the follow-up record to that was Euthanasia, and they wanted that to be even more commercial. They started saying, well, we're going to move the mascot to the back of the record, and we're going to change the logo a little bit and stuff, and I was like, why?
Right. Yeah.
You know, and it was sad. It was very sad. And Euthanasia was number four. And to me, I thought that it was a good record, but it certainly wasn't as fast as it had initially been demoed. And if you watch the making of Euthanasia, it's a thing called Evolver. You can see Max Norman. Max has got a lazy eye, so he's cross-eyed. So he's sitting there counting with a metronome and trying to slow everything down to 130 beats per minute. And I'm like, you can't have every single song on the record the same tempo. It's going to end up being like Wish You Were Here, you know, it's like a 10-part record.
And right.
Long story boring, to have the pressure to follow up a record with something that sounds like somebody else, yes, that definitely happened.
Well, I'm glad it didn't work out that way, just as a
fan.
Was
hard. Because
that's amazing for me because, like, for a time, like, especially, like, in the height of, like, when MTV was working and playing bands mm-hmm. and actually playing music, like, you guys were, like, the premier, like, metal band. Mm-hmm. Being, you know, so why would anybody want to fuck with that formula? I mean, not even that it is a formula, but you know what I'm saying?
I don't know.
Like, you're off doing, like, you know, the conventions, the Democratic conventions. Your song is in the news, you know, it's in the news clip, you know, you're every fucking movie that comes out. Why would someone want to tweak that? Because of Billy Ray Cyrus? Are you fucking kidding me?
I don't
me?
Know. Every village has got its own idiot, I guess. I don't know. The guy that was the president of Capitol when we were doing Cryptic Writings came into the studio and made fun of the clothes I was wearing. And I looked at him and I thought, we could bury you out here and no one would know that you were missing.
You know? Or at least be glad that you are.
Well, the thing is he's gone now, and I didn't think that he left anything as a legacy behind him. I don't know one thing that he did. I mean, at least some of the guys that were there did something, you know, that contributed to Capitol's greatness, and, you know, I can't think of a damn thing he did.
Yeah. Yeah. I've got some horrible Capitol stories myself. I mean, it was just, once it got to a point where they wouldn't let me out, mm-hmm. but they wouldn't let me make music either.
Mm-hmm. So you're like Marcus Allen.
Which is basically, yeah, yeah, a lot like him, except mm-hmm. white. But apart from that, and not a football player. But, you know what I'm saying? Like, I was just fucking trapped. And it was like, and the ironic thing is, if you look out my window, that's what I see as Capitol Records now. Like, I gotta look at that.
You need to move your furniture around.
No kidding. No kidding. But, you know, it's still, I mean, I look at it as like this epic building that a lot of history came out of, mm-hmm. and really great things happened back in the day. But, so what else is going on now? I mean, I know you're gonna...
Well, we're leaving April 8th to Denver to start Gigantor, and we're going out with In Flames and Children of Bodom, and we wanted Children of Bodom to be on the first Gigantor in 2005,
yeah, yeah.
But evidently Alexi had said something about John Petrucci, the guitar player from Dream Theater, mm-hmm. and said that he was a robot and didn't have any feeling, and he was really mechanical, and I thought, and, you know, yeah. I mean, he's a genius guitar player, and, you know, I mean, when you get that good, at some point, you kind of lose a little bit of your feeling, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I would rather play like Jimmy Page than like John, but I recognize his talent, and John and Mike had already confirmed, so I, you know, we had to pass on Children of Bodom, but they're on this one, as well as a band called Job for a Cowboy, who just did Gigantor with us over in the UK, and a band called High on Fire, which is from Oakland, so... I'm looking forward to doing that. We're going up into Canada as well as in North America, and then down to South America, and then the tour ends. So
yeah,
and it's been over a year so far, and you know, we've gone into some new countries that we've never been in before, like Singapore and Thailand, and you know, going to India. I got to tell you, Singapore was okay. Thailand was a blast.
Really?
Don't get massages there.
No.
No, because you end up doing stuff you don't want to do.
Well, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong. No.
No, because you end up doing stuff you don't want to do.
Well, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, Todd, you can go to Thailand, you can actually purchase a human being for very cheap. Right?
Yeah, for the price of a massage.
Yeah.
And try and get rid of them.
Wow, that's awesome, man. So is it true that the Gigantor was named after Gigantor?
The cartoon?
To a degree, yeah?
Yeah. Well, I liked that cartoon when I was a kid. Back when I was growing up, and cartoons back then actually were fun, and it wasn't all about putting people down, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, it's like all comedy nowadays. I mean, I liked Get Smart. I liked the Three Stooges and stuff like that. And you know, you can't even watch anything on TV anymore without somebody just ripping somebody else. And I like comedy.
You're right.
But, you know, I don't really like watching people get put down, because it just it incites a part of me to go back to that sarcastic place, you know, where you just put people down all the time.
Oh, yeah.
That's hard enough to get by in life. That's why people get fat and lazy. Life is hard, so you don't need somebody who you look up to saying, you know, you're a loser or stuff like that.
Sure, sure. I mean, I say that stuff to, you know, for when the cameras aren't rolling. Mm-hmm. Then it's fucking, you know.
I save it for my in-laws.
Anything goes. Yeah, exactly. One thing I've always wanted to ask you, which I know we're running out of time and I want to get to some playing, but just as a guitarist, favorite guitar players, like guys that, you know, are the ones that influenced you the most. Because for the past 2 weeks, I've just, for some reason, I've decided after all my 40 years of living that it just kind of comes down to Ed Van Halen. Mm-hmm. That's where I'm at.
Yeah, Eddie's very talented. I think it goes back to his classical roots, but for me, it was Jimmy Page. I just went over and saw the concert there and got to sit over where Jimmy's family was, and that for me was one of the most ridiculous things in my life, because Ross Halfin, you know, Ross is Jimmy's best friend, and he asked me if I wanted a ticket to the concert. I'm like, are you kidding?
Yeah.
You know, so granted, the plane ticket was ridiculous because it's last minute getting a plane ticket to England.
Of course.
But I went and saw Led Zeppelin, and it was fantastic. That's one of my heroes. Angus Young is one of my heroes. Michael Schenker was one of my heroes, but he's going through a lot of personal stuff right now, and it's really hard for me to hold him in esteem watching the personal decisions that he's doing.
Wow.
And I like Stevie Ray Vaughan, that kind of approach to guitar.
Yeah, of course.
You know, I think Eric Johnson is respectable too, although he's a little bit more kind of foo-foo kind of guitar player than Stevie. I thought Stevie was a, you know, badass.
And yeah. I mean, I would love to get into some playing, you know, because what we're trying to do here is get guys like yourself that I look up to as guitar players and as artists, musicians, and just, like, kind of see where they're coming from playing-wise, you know?
Sure.
So if you could show me some shit, I'd be...
I don't know if I can show you anything. I'll show you what I'm doing, but I'm sure you know it all.
You could teach it to me.
Okay.
I think you could. All right, let's hear it for Dave Mustaine. We're going to be back after this. Thank you so much. That was rad. Fucking Dave Mustaine right here. That was fucking awesome.
Yeah, it was amazing.
What an amazing guy. What an amazing guitar player.
Yeah.
And as you know, I was fortunate enough to sit down with Dave, guitars in hand, and have a little lesson, little guitar lessons with Dave Navarro.
Well, basically, yeah, it's a new installment of our new little thing that we have. That will be many more of Guitar Lessons with Dave Navarro, which we don't want to allude to the fact that you'd be giving lessons.
No, they're just with me. I'm actually taking the
You're
lesson.
Actually getting the lesson, which, you know, I've heard you play a couple of things at my house, and so you might need a few lessons.
Yeah, I'm down, dude. You know, you can... I'll tell you, man, you can never stop learning and honing your craft, and, you know, who better to learn from than the guys I grew up listening to, and Dave's certainly one of those guys.
Shredder.
He's amazing, and I know we got Warren DeMartini of Rat coming up, so that's going to be fucking badass, but let's take a look at the first installment of Guitar Lessons with Dave Navarro. This is me, Dave Navarro, receiving guitar lessons from legendary guitar master Dave Mustaine. All right, so for the first time here at Spread, we are lucky enough to have Dave Mustaine here with guitar in hand, and I've decided to join him because this is one guy I'd like to sit and watch him play and perhaps pick up a few things. So first, let me ask you, dude, are you like self-taught? You are self-taught.
Yeah,
me too.
I don't know what I'm doing.
I don't either.
Good.
Like when guys start saying numbers and letters and shit, I'm like, what the fuck does that mean?
Yeah.
So you're the same way?
Yes.
Beautiful.
Well, maybe not the same exact way, but...
Well, similar.
I know a little bit, but not a lot, so...
Yeah, I mean, I basically, I'm one of those guitar players that I know the box, as they call it, you know, the typical blues box.
The pentatonic scale. That's what I'm stuck in, yeah.
Are you really?
Yeah,
you don't sound stuck in it. How is it that you sound like you're outside of that box all the time?
Well, maybe you were loaded when you heard it.
No, I was on the way over today.
Well, maybe not then. I don't know. I think that just because it's a blues progression, and you know, to a normal guitar player, if you're just beginning, that's like the pentatonic scale. And it's basically a whole blues thing that I got started off. I mean, when I first started playing, one of the very first records I ever had was a Chuck Berry record. And then you started hearing all the stories, and it's like, ooh.
Yeah, right.
Get rid of the record. But, you know, learning guitar for me, I started with the basics. Like, Led Zeppelin was one of my favorite bands, but I cut my teeth on AC/DC. And one of the first songs I actually learned was Panic in Detroit by David Bowie.
Okay.
And songs like All the Young Dudes, Mott the Hoople, and crap like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, of course, you had to learn Stairway to Heaven, or you couldn't go into Guitar Center. And, you know, just learning some of those basic scales. Now, I heard that there was an enharmonic minor. Well, it's supposed to be a harmonic minor, so I've been saying all these years it's an enharmonic minor. I don't really give a shit. I just know that it's a solo that I use in Wake Up Dead.
Okay.
So.
Let's take a look at that. Because all I know is that box you just showed me.
Okay.
And well, everything else I kind of make up, do by ear.
Mm-hmm. Well, Wake Up Dead solo, I just use this scale. That's the scale, right?
Wow. Yeah.
So, basically moving around inside there. That's about the most exotic one that I do. And then I do a lot of like, and She-Wolf is like.
But that's that scale.
It's like a minor scale.
It's right here?
Yeah. And then I slide down here. Going down and sliding down there, it's a note that you wouldn't think someone would end on because you're changing the whole phrase where your hand's at.
Yeah, because like you got me when you're up in here, and that's still somewhat in like a box that I can like digest.
Mm-hmm.
But you, when you're soloing, like you're flying all over the neck, and that one scale up there, that's just like calculus to me.
Well, you know, like the whole thing to me is like two strings at a time. I just go. It's the same thing. Oops. Same thing.
Yeah.
It's all of those. And like the end of She-Wolf is probably more along our style. It's like. And that's like, you know, what we're saying, staying in a hand shape there. To some of the stuff that is more along the style of you know, my rhythm playing, which is what I made my style off of, was more using my palm for palm muting.
Mm-hmm.
And on the bridge here, when I roll my hand, I don't know if you can get in close enough there, but the blade on the outside of my hand there, when you roll that forward, there's a little bit of flesh there that dampens the strings. And the more that you dampen it, the more the pedaling comes into it. Like.
I just
pull it, dampening it off there. And yeah, when you have it open, you can still hear the sound of the note, the E resonating. And if you get too much, like Train of Consequences, yeah, you can see how it becomes atonal. And
it becomes
like a percussive
more
thing.
Percussive.
Like I was going to rehearsal and I just moved to Arizona and I'm stuck in a monsoon and I had a convertible at the time. Now, if you don't live in Arizona, you don't realize monsoons come out of nowhere.
Yeah.
And I was sitting in a puddle of
water by the time I got to the studio. I was so pissed off, and I picked up my guitar and went. And that's how Train of Consequences was.
Oh, that's right.
And I do a lot of sliding with chords too. When I was
That's it gives it that like sick kind of
groaning sound.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's dope.
And that's the song Hook and Mouth, and mm-hmm. I did a lot of sliding. I did that in a couple songs in my previous band, but I can't remember what the songs were. But in Hook and Mouth is. Light up on that last one. See, it's really heavy.
Yeah.
And then there's another thing
When you're tracking those, does the bass slide with you as well?
Yes.
Yeah, that's
yeah. The bass has got an approach of like fat guitar. And lead bass kind of thing. Same thing with the drums. And when I don't play drums, but I can write drum parts.
Right.
And when I think of the drum as a melodic instrument instead of a percussive instrument, you know, you can do solos going this way, going back the other way.
True.
Some of the stuff in the beginning, there was a lot of articulation with the guitars and the drums together.
Yeah.
So, like in Holy Wars, the beginning is. It's just a run. And then the drums come in. Kadalik, 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 kadalik. It's just triplets.
Yeah.
And then it goes into the song. And the drums, if they're just picked up like kaput, like every Al Green song that there is, you know, it's just a dull beginning.
So when you're at home or like when you're approaching guitar to write, like one thing I get asked a lot is, do I practice? And like, do you, as a guitar player, sit down and practice?
No,
I don't either.
I like to write when I pick up the guitar, and because I'm not set up to record,
mm-hmm.
when I pick up the guitar, if I'll play something, usually it escapes me.
Yeah.
And it's gone forever. And
I usually call my voicemail and play it into my voicemail. Mm-hmm.
I have a pocket cassette recorder that I keep on me. That was one of the reasons why my marriage got weird at the end, was because I would call my phone in the middle of the night and go, okay, when I die, I'll be released from hell. You know, and my ex was going like, what? Who's he talking to?
Who are you talking to?
Yeah, I'm stupid enough to be laying in bed to you calling up some woman. So anyways, long story short, again, with Holy Wars, there's some different chord patterns too, where I inverted some things.
Like, yeah, that's interesting.
That's a real hellish chord right there.
Oh, I really like that.
Same chord on this string right here, but then go draw it down. It's really evil. So that part right there, if you heard it, it's real. Bar chord, because the other thing is the exclamation on the whole thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's only a couple other tricks that I have. It's like the spider chord, which I did in, what was the last song? That's one of them.
Yeah, what's that all about?
That was the song I did before. Yeah, you don't have to jump off the strings, yeah. That's a spider chord.
That's insane.
Yeah. That's basically it. Like when I did it in Metallica, it was a.
That's really interesting.
And in Megadeth, in Wake Up This. Thank you. right? So
yeah. Now, is that something that you kind of just...
That's my invention.
You invented that to,
yeah, because I was
to
lazy.
Save yourself the trouble.
It was too much noise.
Yeah. Yeah, because I mean, I'm obviously very familiar with, like, those kind of chords. But to do that, that's a whole mind trip for me.
Yeah, you got to leave the other hand down there. It's just a temporary thing, yeah.
Doesn't have the same...
It's not.
It doesn't have the same
feel. Because
you
pick up. It's, the other chord isn't sustaining.
That's badass.
So there's so much time in between it when you pick up. And it just kills the chord.
So I come up with a lot of stuff in the studio. Mm-hmm. Like in there's one song where I inserted to get super high. I just pull this... I pull it way up there. Mm-hmm. And... But live, it's nearly impossible to get into that position and come off of that.
How many frets is on that guitar?
This 21? One? I don't know. I have no idea.
It's 24. Fret, yeah. Well, what I used to do was I had a Bill Lawrence pickup that had the blades on it. This
so
is too low right
the
here.
Pickup, right?
You can play the pickup. You were going to do it, but, you know, you'd have to have the pickup raised up a little bit more, and because the Bill Lawrence has the blade on it, mm-hmm. it's almost like a fret wire.
Yeah, that's right.
So it turns into that Uli Roth 600 fret guitar.
Absolutely.
You ever seen that guitar he has?
The guy's fucking insane. But what I'm asking is more about, like, getting into that position.
How do you do it?
Without it being like...
Yeah, it's just a matter of not clunking around.
When learning, you know, because what I'm saying is, like, some of the stuff I come up with in the studio, I can't do it live.
Yeah, sure.
Because it's going to sound like, you know, this.
If I was going to do it standing up.
Right. This is fucking awesome, by the way. Here's my other sound check song, by the way.
Reckoning day. Okay.
Get used to that, Riss.
Okay, so if I was going to do this, the part in Washington is next. After I get done singing, I usually go, and I got the strap on backwards, but I'll pinch the guitar between my legs, and I'll have it back here so it's balancing this way. I walk away and I'm smiling, so because I know no one else can do that.
That is fucking the shit, dude. Well, Dave, thanks so much for coming here and playing guitar with me, and let's hear it for Dave Mustaine, man. Some amazing shit. And I think that if we learned anything as guitar players, like, yeah, you know, there's the typical stuff and you can learn and pay attention to what everybody else is doing, but truly it's kind of about just inventing your own technique, your own sound,
yep.
And that's what will set you apart as a player. Right on, man. Thank you so much, dude.
You're welcome.
Appreciate it.
You got it, buddy.
One more time. And we will be back with a less amazing part of the show right after this.
I know you said you want him, so let's bring him out. Dave Mustaine! All right, here he is! There's a lot of people in this room that are wearing Megadeth t-shirts and have definitely a lot of musicians that have been inspired by Megadeth. Who inspired you? Like, what made you decide you wanted to pick up a guitar?
Well, as far as influencing me to play guitar and influences as a musician, they're totally different because, thank you, I love you too. For musicians, the music I listened to growing up was... It was different from what I play because I have two older sisters that are considerably older than me. So we grew up listening to Motown and the Beatles and stuff like that, and stuff with a lot of feeling to it. And when I started playing guitar, I started listening to people like AC/DC and Iron and UFO, and then I discovered the new wave of British heavy metal in my last band, and had found some music like Diamond Head and Merciful Fate. So that's a little different for me. My guitar playing influence is more from the 80s, but my musical influence is from the 70s.
How do you approach songwriting? Like, what's the songwriting process like for you?
Well, most people think that there's a formula with the songwriter, and it's not like I start with lyrics first or that I start with music first. Usually it's just a feeling that I get. Like when I wrote Train of Consequences, I just moved to Arizona and I bought a convertible, and they have things called monsoons in Arizona, which means that there's a storm out of nowhere, right? And I had the roof down in my car, and then all of a sudden there was a huge rain cloud above my car, and by the time I got to the studio, I picked up my guitar and I was like, and just beating the guitar because I was pissed. I was soaking wet, and so was the inside of my car. So songs like In My Darkest Hour, the music was written, I'd gotten a phone call from somebody named Maria Ferrara. We finally know her as Metal Maria in the East Coast. She was one of the people that were around when Metallica first got signed out there. And she called me up and told me that Cliff had died, and I was really disappointed about that, and not so much, obviously anybody's going to be disappointed with the loss of human life, but that I didn't hear it from my bandmates or my ex-bandmates. And what happened was I immediately went down to downtown Los Angeles, because at the time I was doing a lot of really bad stuff for my health, and I got really loaded, and I went back and I played guitar, and that was how the song was born. It was based on Cliff's dying. Now, the lyrics to In My Darkest Hour have nothing to do with Cliff at all. It had to do with Diana, who is a girl that I dated for a while and wrote several songs about. Wake Up Dead, Tornado of Souls, Trust, Love to Death, a lot of songs. I mean, she's very popular in my mind.
So a lot of the songs that you've written have to do with a lot of personal experiences and sharing.
Yeah, and I think that's a cool thing too, because I've been really open and upfront with our fans over the years. So it's been a story that people have been able to watch develop over the years with me, with my life, and you know, who's been in the band, who's not been in the band. Just for the record, I don't like lineup changes. It's uncomfortable, and you have to remember somebody else's name. So this opportunity for me to do this for Guitar Center and to come and share with you about the musician side of this is why I'm here. I'm not here to answer smart-ass hecklers. I'm here to talk to you guys about, you know, what to do with your career. So we can take this one of two ways. We can talk about, you know, why I'm here, what influenced me, what made me the musician I am, what can I do to help you, or we can make it funny, ha-ha, and you know, you walk away thinking, well, I didn't really get anything out of that. And that's not why I came all the way up here from San Diego, was to be funny, because I can be funny over the phone.
So in talking about amps for a second, you've been a longtime Marshall amp user. What is it about Marshall that allows you to get the sound that you're looking for?
Well, the comments tonight about how much the British invasion and the new wave of British heavy metal has influenced me. Obviously, that Marshall sound was dominant in all of those bands. And if you go back at that time, I mean, who was making amps back then? There was Marshall and there was not, you know? And, you know, I just found out Marshall was making Vox amplifiers, and I'm thinking, no wonder I like the Beatles. They were playing Marshalls disguised as Voxes, you know? But for me, I think that it's got a really classic English sound. My rig that I use in the studio is different from the rig that I use on the road. On the road, I use what's called an EL34-100 dual monoblock, which is basically a power amp. It's a Marshall power amp. It's a bad amp. And I was using a Rocktron Prophecy for my preamp and all of my effects switching, and I recently moved over to Digitech's new product, but I can't remember the number. It's Digitech something that Dave uses. That's it. What is it? Thank you. Give that man a cigar. All right. Okay, so that's what I'm using, and I found that that effects unit is actually, for me, it offers more of what I need than what I had before, and I was absolutely content with the Rocktron Prophecy and using the Marshalls, but when I started using the Digitech coupled with the Marshall, it was like, you know, I've arrived, my sound's here, everything that I can, you know, want to do with the guitar is there. You know, when you switch back and forth between lead punches, if you're going into a lead solo and you switch into the rhythm sound at the end of the solo, there's an interface that they have this clicking sound on the pedal boards, and on some of the pedal boards you click it, when you switch back over to rhythm you can tell that you switched. The DSP, whatever it is, has the spillover effect so that the solo will carry over when you go back into your rhythm sound, and I really liked that. I also liked that it offered much more increments to the effects itself. Like, I was using a Marshall JMP 1 preamp a long time ago, but it's notched, which means that it doesn't have like a potentiometer that you can turn. It's like clicks, like an old TV. And I found that it didn't have enough availability for me to customize it to what I needed. So I switched from that over to the Prophecy, and then the GSP set that up. But going back to playing live, a lot of guys, when they go out and play live, they'll use like the classic JMP, the 800s, which was what I had in the very beginning. I had a lot of those, and it's just they're as different and as complicated as any woman I've ever met. Every amplifier has its own color and sound and quality, and the tubes heat up at different speeds, and that's the beauty about the Marshall stuff, is it's not like you can pick one up and it's going to sound just like the next one. After a time, it picks up its own character. Like, and hot rodding amplifiers, you know, there's guys here in Hollywood that hot rod amps, you know. I mean, Lee Jackson was doing it for a long time. He had hot rodded one of my amps, and I didn't like the way it sounded, so I ended up giving it to Jeff Young. He loved it.
Does anybody, if you raise your hand, if you have any questions for Dave? Right there.
Can you still play Rust in Peace?
Can I still play it?
Yeah.
I'd have to learn it. After having over 100 songs, that's a lot of songs to remember. You know, it's like remembering 100 kids' names.
Well, here, where'd you buy your first guitar at?
Where'd I buy my first guitar? I actually stole it. But listen, this is what I did. I contacted the guy that I stole it from, and I said, look, you know what, I was a drug addict and an alcoholic at the time, and I needed to do the right thing in order to, you know, get off of drugs, and I need to make it right with you. I stole a guitar from you. Now, the guitar I stole from him was a piece of shit. I ended up giving him one of my Jacksons, so he made out, you know. But, I mean, the bottom line is, you know, doing the right thing. It's like Phil from Armored Saint. I broke his leg. He asked me if there's ever anything I could do for him. I said, you know, is there anything I can do for you? You just let me know. He called up and said, I want a guitar. And I'm like, are we done? So I sent him a guitar.
Dave, I think one of the hardest things for an artist to do is to hand off their art to give to somebody on a business sense.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find it hard to get involved in the business sense of it, or do you find it difficult to hand it off?
I get involved?
I mean, like, on the business side, you know, you have to hand it off to make it to be bigger than you really are.
Yeah.
On the business side. So,
well, there's certain people that you have to hand it off to. As, for example, I'm not an accountant, you know. I mean, when I count, it's like one for you, one for me, one for you, two for me, you know, that kind of thing. But, you know, it's like, you know, same thing with the legal matters. I don't consider myself to be an attorney. Now, you know, I usually know when I'm in trouble enough to where I'm going to get sued, or if I'm doing something where, you know, somebody will need to be sued, you know. And I think if you surround yourself with strong minds and people that are decent people, that's one of the first things that, you know, I mean, you can hand it off to anybody. You got to make sure you give it to the right person. It's like that one highlight of that Pittsburgh Steelers, I think, the guy that got the football and ran the wrong way. Was he a Steeler or Viking? Steeler or Viking? Whatever.
Hey, Dave, what are your true feelings nowadays about Dave Allison?
Oh, I think I've talked about him pretty nicely tonight. I think you can tell that if I hated him, I wouldn't have used his name. And I actually forgave him when it's funny, in our business, you can do things like, I won't get into naming any individual stuff, but you can do things and do really terrible stuff in our business and be forgiven for it, you know. For me, I said that I believe in God in P-Cells, but who's buying? The first line, what do you mean I don't believe in God? I talk to him every day. Well, I tell people that I'm a Christian and their ass grows together. You know, I don't think that's fair. I mean, what is what I believe in have anything to do with you or my music? Nothing. Well, I got to walk the walk and talk the talk. So when Ellison and I went our separate ways, I had an opportunity to go and talk with him. Now, it was at my doing to go find him in Phoenix and to go and say, hey, I just wanted to tell you I forgive you. Now, he sued me for $18.5 million and dragged my name through the mud, and it was really devastating for me because this is one of my best little friends, you know, and I wish him well. I hope that he's got something that he's doing in the music business right now, and there's not really much more to say.
Hi, Dave, I have a question regarding your gear. I remember a while back I saw a video on YouTube, you using a Line 6 amp.
Right, right.
I want to know, how long did you last with Line 6?
How long did I last?
Yeah.
Well, I've got real stay power. The thing with Line 6 was when I went over there, they modeled Marshall amplifiers anyway. So what they had said, I have a friend of mine that had a Plexi, an old Marshall Plexi head, and it sounded amazing. And he had just a really killer old antique cabinet. And I said, you know what, can I rent this to record the record, you know? And it was just such a pain in the butt getting this guy to let me use his stuff to record with. I figured, you know what, I'm just going to have someone copy this. And so I rented it from him, and the guy said Line 6 duplicated it. Now, for me, getting out on the road, it's a lot different when your stuff is shaking back and forth, you know, for miles and miles and miles and miles and miles, and then you go and you plug in somewhere and it doesn't come on. You know, you want to make sure that you've got gear that can be easily replaced out on the road. You also want to make sure you've got something that's going to stand the rigors of being out on tour. You know, the Line 6 amps that I have sound great, but they're really finicky and they don't do well bouncing around the ground. Now, that has nothing to do with Line 6 amps in general, because this was a custom amp that they did for me.
I want to ask all the things I need to stay away from. You know, the evil things, sex, drugs, alcohol, or something else. What's the worst one out of all am I going to stay away from?
Stay away from?
Scariest one.
I don't know. It feels like a loaded question. You know, for me, I think the most dangerous thing in the music business was people who will tell you what you want to hear. And, you know, I mean, you know who they are. They're the people that will come over and steal your drugs and help you look for them, you know. It's the kind of people that will, you know, they'll ask you to borrow money, and then when you ask them back for it, they'll never, I didn't borrow any money off you. You know, I think the most important thing is you surround yourself with the right people. I mean, as soon as you think you've seen the worst thing, there's something new. This last tour, it's like every time we turn the corner, there was something new. Then you're just like, oh my God, I think I've seen everything, and then you don't. I went into Brazil, we went up into the north part of Brazil, and then we went up to Peru. And in order to get back into Brazil, I had to get an inoculation for yellow fever, because for some reason Brazil and those other countries up there has a problem with yellow fever. Now, I got yellow fever after they gave me that shot, because, you know, when they give you a shot, you get a little bit of the virus, and your body has to build up an antivirus to it. And I got really sick. I was sick for 2 weeks, just dying every day. Now, nobody knew it on stage, because I'm not a whiner when it comes time to getting up on stage. You won't know anything's wrong with me on stage. I mean, I may walk off if something's unsafe for me. But, you know, I think that as far as what's the most dangerous thing in the music business, it's man.
I thought maybe we'd listen to a couple of our favorite, maybe some snippets of our favorite Megadeth songs, maybe talk about it, if that's okay with you.
Okay.
Maestro, song number one, please.
the picking pattern in Holy Wars is really different. When the riff that makes up the beginning part, there's a lot of picking going on with the right hand. If you watch real closely to my hand right here, if you notice the last three chords, so I went back to the major chords because coming out of those minors made the major chords sound much more powerful. So the part, if you notice the difference between right here, the second round of chords for you that don't play guitar is the major chords. The way that I do them, I use two notes. It sounds heavier with just those two notes too. It's not quite as noisy. And that was one of the first things with that song where I knew I was really onto something, was hearing those upside down chords, the way that they were coming together, and the way that they contrasted going with the minors versus the major chords. Then where that song took off and went into the second portion of the song, which is called The Punishment Due, that song was influenced, the entire song was influenced by The Punisher from Marvel Comics, which is, you know. We were doing a demo with this famous engineer, and his name is Garth, and he stutters. So even in his signature, it's Garth. And he was the guy that actually helped Ellison come up with the bass line in he helped him come up with those broken notes like that, and I thought, well, that sounds really great. It's cool stuff, you know, it works. And going into the second part of that song is where it kind of drops down, and you kind of, in a live situation, for me, what I've always tried to do is start really strong and then kind of settle into, you know, a groove, and then finish as climactic as possible. I mean, it works great with concerts and a lot of other things, but when you go into the second part of Holy Wars, which is called Punishment Due, you go into some more of those minor chords again. The minor chord is right here. So there's a lot of going back and forth between the minors and the major chords. The very end of the song is solo time, and this is the only solo in Megadeth's history that I did in one take. And some of them, you know, they've taken quite a few attempts to get the solo done, but this was one of those solos that you just hear it and you know it's special. That's why there's feedback in the beginning of it, because we turned the amp up so loud that, you know, it was ready. The amp was basically just vibrating, and I opened up the volume like that, and I went, oh, that's really loud. And I turned it back down, and so then the guy goes, just go for it, and I went, okay. And then I did the pull off, and I just started shredding, going down this long run that goes all the way down the bottom. And I hit an open string, and I look over, and the guy's bouncing off of the console, and Menza and Ellison are in there bouncing, and they're like, yeah, and I'm like, shut up. And we get to the end part, and where it's pulling off, this is a really interesting thing too. When you capo across those strings right there, basically the pull off is on these two strings, the B and the G. That's you can hear in the background, this E has got a slight overtone where it's ringing out. That's the solo where it climbs at the end there. And you have that little part ringing over on the background there, which is an added little nuance that if you're not listening for it, you're not going to pick it up. But those are a lot of the cool little tricks with guitar playing that I personally love to bring to songs. That's Holy Wars, that's The Punishment Due.
I bet you guys weren't expecting that. If we could talk about gear for a second, since you got this is your signature guitar, semi-new. Did you have input in the design of this at all?
Well, the original shape, obviously, as we all know here, is based on the Gibson Flying V, which was modified by Jackson for their King V, which I left and went to ESP, and then I went over to Dean. And Dean, this guitar is more similar to the Jackson, I think, than the ESP was, because the president for ESP was apprehensive to getting too close in similarity to the Jackson body lines, because he didn't want a lawsuit. And face it, we're in a country that we're sue happy. We're a litigious people. You know, he didn't want to do it, and after a while, I just figured, you know what, this isn't what I like. I mean, it may be off by, you know, a half inch to you, and that may not be a lot, but I'll tell you, if you're running through a doorway at, you know, 10 miles an hour, and you miss the doorway by a half inch, you can feel it, you know? So, I mean, if the guitar's off by a half inch, you know, I'm going to feel it, and I certainly want to play what I like playing. And when we started developing this guitar, I had immediately thought of Dean, and I thought of the headstock, and I thought, you know, I'm not a three on tuning peg kind of guy. I've always been six in a row. When I played BC Rich in the very beginning of my career with Metallica, I'd had three on each side, and I found it really difficult for me to remember switching sides, you know, which way you turn it, and you know, there's only so much time you have live. You know, I live for the stage. I'm not talking to you about being in the studio where you can take your time. I'm talking about when you're on stage and you've got a nanosecond to get your guitar back in tune. I had said that, you know, I was concerned about the headstock, and as you can see, so were they. So I've got my six in a row, and we wanted to make a change to the body so that it would be different enough so that they would feel good about it, and they wouldn't feel like they were infringing on Gibson or Jackson. So they did this little notch right here, and I'm thinking, man, if you can, good idea, thank you. I can say thanks. Now, if you see right here, there's a little notch right here, and that's all well and good as long as you're not hitting it at 80 miles an hour with frozen hands in England, you know. And I tell you, the first time I did that, I really hurt my hand. And so if it was me, I would probably, once you buy this thing, I would play with a mitten on or I'm just kidding. And the guitar itself, too, is a lot heavier than the previous guitar that I was playing, so it sustains a lot better, and I think it's got a little bit more meat on it. And when we were out doing the Heaven and Hell tour last year with the lineup from Black Sabbath, one of the things that I'd noticed was that I was actually able to hear my solos better. And, you know, you kind of like, yeah, I'm good, you know, this kind of thing. You're telling yourself you're better than you really are. But I was listening, and I was like, you know what? I can really hear some areas in my playing that I was having some problems with, and it had cleaned itself up. And it wasn't necessarily something that it, you know, is like rocket science where you had to figure out, you know, what was the primary thing that got corrected. Well, the thing that got corrected was me. It was playing the guitar, the confidence in the guitar, the way that it felt, the way that it felt in my hands, the way that I held it. And then I was up in here, and I think I was doing a solo for, it doesn't matter, there's so many of them. It was one of the songs off of one of the last records, because I remember that it was just recently that I started to notice that I had played it right. But anyways, the guitar for me too, when you get up into the higher frets here, I use the small fret wire, because the pads on the tips of my finger, they're not as big as, you know, some of those dudes that look like they're a pack of hot dogs for fingers. But when my skin's pretty soft, so when my fingers get flattened out, they take up a lot of space here on the top. And when I'm getting it on, like with some of the songs where, you know, you'll be pulling off or something, that's something that you do for Hangar 18. Now, it's hard to do sitting down, and it's hard to do without a band blasting behind me. But, you know, it's so stretched out, and I'm playing something that I'm not used to playing. For me, having the small fret wire makes the guitar a lot easier to play. It has signature active pickups in it that are made by Seymour Duncan and Tone Pro knobs and a stop tailpiece. That's basically all that there's to say about this guitar. There's different models, so that if you're a beginner guitar player, there's an entry-level guitar, there's a semi-pro model, and then there's the pro model like this, which is totally different, as my friend here found out today, right?
You started what has turned out to be a great metal tour that's on its, what do you have, third year?
It started on 05, so it's gone three times through the States. And
we're talking about Gigantor, of course, a great metal tour that has, you know, changed over the years. And what I think is really cool is I've sat down and talked to all the bands that you've had on the various years, and they all say nothing but Dave's wants to make sure that we're taken care of and that, you know, we've got enough space on the stage and that everybody feels, you know, comfortable and welcome.
Enough LSD in the water.
Everybody that I've talked to has had a great experience, and it's really cool because I feel like as an artist who's been through a lot and has seen things go well and go poorly, that you're taking your knowledge and you're, you know, taking things that could go wrong and making it into something good from your experiences and sharing that. What do you see for the future of Gigantor? Is this something that you want to see for years to come, like Ozfest?
Well, Gigantor was, in essence, when my arm got hurt, I had put my arm over the back of a chair, and on the inside of my arm right here, there's a nerve, and the nerve had been pinched, so I couldn't play guitar anymore. And you know, when people say, what do? People usually say, I am a, right? I am a guitar player. And I kept thinking, no, that's not what I am. That's what I do. I am Dave Mustaine. I play guitar. That's what I do. And then when I couldn't play anymore, I didn't realize what a huge part of me the guitar had become. And it was really strange to get that injury. So going into hiatus, when we came off of the 2001 tour, I had had a terrible relationship with the band members at the time because we'd had new management, and it was basically divide and conquer was the mentality of this manager at the time. And when the band went into mothballs, you know, I thought there's no need for us to talk about playing again. And you know, as far as like getting hurt, it really affected, you know, so much of you know, who I am. I kept thinking, God, you know, I'll never play again. I picked up the guitar, and my hand wouldn't even talk to my brain. It just, you know, you see people with disabilities, until you really have one yourself, you don't know what a bummer it is. And I really lost a big part of myself there. So I thought, I want to be involved in the music industry still, and I have a lot of experience and a lot of knowledge that I would like to be able to share with these young new musicians before I go off into retirement and you never see me again, and you guys hit the stage and somebody takes advantage of you and really hurts you. So that was my whole intent for Gigantor, was to be able to have a festival that was cutting edge, that had really great talented bands that had guitar players in and that played guitar solos. You know, and you know, there's just a lot of I think a lot of tourists that go out right now that don't have that kind of diversity with it either. So Gigantor was basically set up as an opportunity for me to be able to give back to you guys and let you share the stage with me and see what it's like to be, you know, up there with the big dogs. And you know, one of the things that I've done every time we've done Gigantor is the night before the festival, I meet with all the bands and I say, okay, I'm Dave, blah, 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 shake all their hands, even the road crew, because it's important. The band makes it rock, the crew makes it roll. So we meet all these guys, and I tell them, I want you to know that there's a lot of people that want Gigantor to succeed. There's a lot of people that want it to fail. And if anything goes wrong with your gear, your guitars, anything, you can use my stuff. Not long, but you can use it. And, you know, it would have helped if I would have known that most of the people in Gigantor this year didn't speak English, but...
Control.
Los Angeles over by Burbank, a little city called Toluca Lake. And I used to train at a place called the Jet Center with Benny the Jet Yukitas. I was coming back from training one day, and I thought, you know, part of my wanting to be a big karate master was you have to eat sushi every day after you go work out. So I was on my way to go eat sushi, and I'm driving back, and I wrote on the back of this receipt from the sushi plate, my metal brain's corroding, my head's going to explode. And I went, oh, wow. And that was the beginning of the lyrics for Symphony of Destruction. So it was a martial arts sushi-induced coma that had given me the thing. Thank God for sushi, right. So anyways, with this song right here, it's pretty simple. It's just going back and forth between F and E. Anyway, so with Symphony of Destruction, it moves from a typical kind of like a blues bar, kind of, you know, the 12-bar blues, whatever you call that crap, to where it goes into the setup for the solo, which we have our own vernacular in the studio. It's like the pre-chorus would be like this part. That would be the pre-chorus, right? The part that sets up for the chorus. And I'm going to play this really quiet right here. So that's all the action that's going on behind there. So it doesn't necessarily sound like all that picking's going on. And you set something like that up underneath a guitar solo, it gives your guitar soloist a lot of room to do his solo. And for me, the way we would pick solos was if the rhythm was really difficult, since I was a better rhythm player than a better lead player, when a rhythm part would come up and it was difficult, thank you, I would take the more difficult rhythm parts, and because I didn't know how to solo as well over those difficult parts as some of the gunslingers that I've had with me, I knew it was better for us all if I would take the stuff that I could play and that I would give them the stuff that they were more suited to be playing. So Marty did the solo in symphony, and something that's really unique, and I've never seen this anywhere else in the world with any other band. I'm sure that it happens with everybody, but I'm just in one band, I just don't see it. When we went to Argentina, they sing this word in between, they sing the chorus, or the chords is what they sing. They sing, they go, aguante, mega death. So they're saying aguante, and I'm like, what is aguante, right? And I'm immediately thinking aguave, you know, it's tequila. All right, Sammy Hagar, you know? And it's supposed to mean something like keep going on, don't ever quit. And it's funny for me when I go into other countries outside of Argentina and hear people singing that part, because that's kind of like their part now, you know what I mean? And when you hear people singing your rhythm parts, it's mind-boggling. So going back to the chorus part with this song, that would be the pre-chorus part. And there's a lot of vibration of strings too, like right before the step-down part. If you don't get that vibration in there and you're a two-guitar team, you've got to make sure your other guitar player is doing the vibrato in unison with you, because if not, the two of you are like... It's like, I mean, that may work for, you know, some of these new bands, but that don't work for me, you know? And then the chorus on Symphony was really simple, too. It was going back to what influenced me as a musician. I'd said that the Beatles were one of my influences as a musician, and they had a lot of moving bass lines underneath their choruses and stuff. And if I do the chords for you, it totally makes sense, because you watch the progression. That's the chorus, basically, for Symphony, but when I pick it... You got to do all those vibratos in there. It totally gives it a different feeling when you start actually arpeggiating those chords. So, Symphony of Destruction.
when you guys go back into the studio and you're writing music, do the other band members get a say or input on your songs?
Here we go back into politics. Of course, they'll get their say. If what they've got is good, we'll use it. If it's not, it's not going to be used. I mean, at the end of the day, the most important thing for Megadeth music is that the music passed the quality test. And there was a period when Marty Friedman was in the group. We were continuing to go down a path that we were becoming more and more alternative sounding, and I didn't like that. And I talked to Marty when we were doing Cryptic Writings, and we had just written a song, and he said, "Dude, I'm all about that," because he used to start every sentence with "Dude, I'm all about that." And I said, "Are you kidding? Why don't we just do something really slow like this? Na 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 na." And I started playing the guitar riff to The Doctor's Calling, and it was really basically mocking him, because I was thinking, this is the mighty f***ing Megadeth, and now you've got me playing music at like 20 beats per minute, and it's like, what happened? Where did we go wrong? So a lot of the band's formative years made Megadeth the Megadeth that we all know and love, and then there was a period where the success, because of the heavy metal influence into the world, the record company saw what we were doing and wanted to influence us to make another Countdown to Extinction. Well, you know, it ain't easy having a number two record. You can't, if everybody could do it, everybody would do it. So when they said, you know, make another one, I tried. I did that with Euthanasia. It was number four. It wasn't number two, but it wasn't number 10 either. And, you know, it was one of those situations where you're getting pressured from the record company. And some of you can, you know, ask yourselves, you know, well, why wouldn't you be able to tell the record company what to do? Well, the truth is when you're in the music industry,
you're the bank.
Me, myself, to them, I'm not Dave Mustaine. I have a SKU number. That's it. To you, I'm Dave, I'm your buddy, I'm your pal, I'll stick up for you, I'll be funny, you know. But to them, you know, they look at us, thank you, I love me too. They look at product and when you make a decision with a band, you know, you affect not only the band members, but their families too. So when you get pressure as a band leader, which I fashion myself as, you've got to make decisions for other people. It's easier if you're in a band with fewer people, because less people get affected by it. But going back to your initial question about, you know, who influences the songs and you know, what is their input? When we had done some of the initial recording back when Nick Manza had come into the group, Nick was a jazz drummer, and he was also Chuck Beeler's roadie. And I had just shot my mouth off in Ireland about the IRA, because somebody was selling t-shirts in the concert, and I said, well, they can't do that. And he goes, well, it's for the cause, Dave, okay? It's for the f***ing cause, okay? And I'm like, what's the cause? So me, naturally being Irish, you know, I wanted to hear about, you know, any Irish folklore, so I could go back to America and, you know, act like I'm more Irish than anybody else who's part Irish. And so somebody said, if you draw a smiley face in the top of a glass of Guinness, you'd have a drinking partner. So I sat down and I'm drawing. You think that's funny, huh? I think you've been doing it. I drew a couple smiley faces, and I listened to the story about the clause, and it made it so simple to me. He said, it's just prejudice religion. One religion thinks it's better than another one. And I thought, well, that's pretty simple for me to figure out in my rock star brain. Prejudice, prejudice, prejudice. And I got up on stage and I said, this one's for the cause. Anarchy in Antrim. And I had been taken out in a bulletproof bus and woke up the next morning in Dublin, and Ellison wouldn't talk to me. And I'm like, what happened? Well, what happened was they had a bomb threat called in, because the IRA up where we were playing in Antrim, it's Northern Ireland, and it's not really popular to be making statements like that. Now, Paul McCartney can say, give Ireland back to the Irish, but I can't, you know. And I guess it has to do with being in the Beatles. But, when the next day I woke up, I talked to Ellison, and he told me what had happened, and the next morning we transported to a place in Nottingham, England called Rock City, and that's where Nick Menza jumped onto the drums for the first time, because Chuck Beeler had gotten really, really wasted, and Nick hated Chuck. He used to call him terrible words that I won't say, but he jumped up on Chuck's kit, and we started what you now fondly know as Holy Wars that day. And Holy Wars is about that episode up in Antrim where I said stuff that I didn't really know anything about because I believed somebody and they told me stuff. And as a songwriter, it's really important if you're going to make a stand on something that you kind of play the gender line in the middle and you don't take any sides or anything like that, because you can get yourself in a lot of problems, like with the Dixie Chicks. I mean, when the chick first said that she was ashamed of Bush, you know, I mean, I think everybody thought she was insane for doing something like that. I think everybody agrees now. And, you know, you do something like that in your career, one bad sentence can ruin your career, guys. I mean, I'm talking to you musicians now. So it's really important that you, if you're a front man and you're doing interviews and you're talking, that you think about what you're saying. You know, being funny, being a badass, and, you know, saying all these kind of things, you know, that works, but it does. It may not work for 25 years.
Being in what is called the music business for as long as you have, I know that you have very strong opinions because you've seen it go from where, let's say, there was a lot of money behind the music business, a lot of labels, to a completely different story now. Obviously, the industry has changed and downloading and, less, you know, whatever it is. What's your opinion today on the state of music business?
Well, the music business for me when I started, it was one word. I know that sounds stupid, but it really was. It was the music business. And when I got in there, there were, you know, fat balding dudes with gold chains sucking on cigars and doing cocaine. And it's like, I've arrived. You know? And, you know, you could get whatever you want. I remember the first day we went to Capitol, there was someone there that had a bunch of champagne, another guy that had cocaine, another guy walked up with a box full of Nikes. And I'm like, all right. But this is cool. You know what I mean? It's funny that the champagne and the cocaine took a backseat to the new shoes, but I mean, those of you that are real musicians get it, you know. I lived in a car to make my career happen. I was homeless for a while. And you know, there's a lot of things that you've really got to be willing to, you know, sacrifice to do this. There's going to be times where you're going to miss birthdays and you're going to miss holidays, you're going to miss anniversaries, you're not going to be home when you need to be home. You know, there's, like for me, I when we released this last record, I had made a promise to my two children that I would be home for the summer with them. Now, the record kept getting pushed back and back and back, and finally when it came out, well, it was right up against that 2-month period, I said I'd be home with my kids. Now, instead of being a douchebag and lying to my kids and going out and playing for you, which I would have been screwing us all, I kept my word, I kept my integrity so that I can be the guy that you look up to. And I stayed home for those 2 months, the first 2 months of the career for this record, this last record, and it really hurt the momentum of the record. But we got great reviews everywhere, thanks to you guys and your support. And the way that I look at the internet, it can be used for good, it can be used for bad. I mean, you know, you can take it to the extent that you go up to Capitol Hill and you ask for people's addresses, or you know, you put some songs and you put some videos up at your website, and you interact with people and you answer emails and you meet your fans and stuff like that. I don't think that it's fair that you would go to a person's house and see their entire catalog of their music downloaded by somebody. I think that's totally unfair. But if you go to a band's website and they've got music stuff and they've got video stuff and they've got some extra media for you to check out, I mean, that's how you keep fans interested. That's how you keep that one-on-one relationship with them. You do things that set you apart, that make you different, you know. And honestly, if I got in this for the money, I would have gotten out a long time ago, because, you know, the pressure and the strain that, you know, happens to a musician's body when you're out on the road and your nervous system, it's really difficult. At the end of the day, you know, the cost versus what you get, it's a diminishing return. So if you really want to do this and this is your career, somebody needs to tell you up front what you need to expect. There's going to be a lot of days where you're going to go without eating. There's going to be a lot of days where you're going to have fights, and most band fights are over women or money. And it's, or drugs, but, you know, I mean, if you've got money, you don't have drug problems, you know, because you can buy your drugs and stuff. And most of the girls in the music industry now, you know, they look at a lot of the bands, and they figure, you know what, I'll just be in one instead of dating a guy, you know, it's, you know, which I think is really a great thing right now, that there's a lot of girls in the music industry. I wish that more people would actually sing, myself personally, because, you know, there's nothing worse than you go up to somebody and you say, who's the singer? And they go, it's her, you know, and you're like, really? For me, I don't really have a practice or a routine that I have for alternate picking. A lot of it is in my hand position. I choke the pick off really, really shallow, so there's not a lot of material sticking underneath my hand. And I also keep the pick so that it's almost parallel to the string, but not too much. Some people, when they have the pick parallel, it's harder to pick the string. I have it just a little bit turned so that it almost nudges the string over. The other thing too for me with some of the picking patterns that I have, they would just be totally inaudible if there wasn't the palm muting technique that I use myself. I like to put the bridge of my hand right here, the meat of it, right across the bridge of the pickup, I mean the bridge there, and just kind of roll it forward to dampen the strings. It's different amounts that I roll it forward to deaden the strings. Like the more that I go up to, sometimes I'll just completely choke the string off. Like in Train of Consequences. I can't start a pattern if there's four notes in there and I'm doing three notes and I want to down pick on the alternate where I'm going. Because of the timing, I'm going to do the fourth note. It's going to be the same thing. It's going to be an up pick on the fourth note. If I want a down pick and I go down, up, down, down, the timing is going to be a little bit suspect when I go from string to string. Sometimes I'll start with an up pick and then go down. So I try and keep it as flowing as possible in between notes. And the other thing too is I cheat a lot when you're asking me how I go back and forth between strings. I'll anchor my finger either on the pickup ring or on the strings. And that's kind of the muscle memory in my hand will tell me how far it is from string to string. Something like that. The injury that I had was called Saturday Night Palsy, and the muscle that comes across the top of your hand here, I had a nerve injury that it was pinched inside of my bicep here on the radial ulnar nerve, and this muscle here stopped communicating with the nerve. So when my hand was in this position, so the palm was facing up, I could pull the muscle up this way, I could close my hand and everything like this. If my hand was in this position where the palm was facing down, I couldn't do nothing. It just hung like that. So because the guitar in this position, you know, the palm is facing up, you would think that something could happen. And it was fine going this way, but when I had to pull my hand back down this way, I couldn't get the muscle to pull this way. So some of the things that I did when I was trying to rehabilitate my arm, and this would be, I mean, for any guitar player who's injured their arm and they think it's the end of the world, it's not. Sometimes you just have to, you know, learn how to play again. I did a lot of physical therapy, which is a lot of stretching exercises, a lot of gripping exercises, a weird wheel that they had. It was like a mesh thing, and you just do these gripping exercises. So having said that, as the muscle came back, I just started doing basic picking patterns, you know, all the blockheaded stuff you learn in the beginning. I couldn't do any of that because, you know, and I would stop as soon as I made a mistake. Start again. Just keep going over and over again. Some of the things that my teacher had shown me, the guy's name is Rick Flouting, and he's done some orchestration work with the London Philharmonic Orchestra. He's a jazz player and a classical player. He may not be, you know, super renowned or anything like that, but for me, he was really good and had the right attitude. If I'm going to go and put myself in the hands of a teacher, I don't want to be with some guy that's going to show me something wrong in the first place. The thing for speeding up for me was pulling my fingers in this way and also not holding on here. And another thing too for fingering is, you know, I was going across the frets like this, and he had said that if I turn my hand this way, it'll be better for me.
because my guitar hangs really low, it's kind of hard to change that, but I try and do it as much as I can to discipline myself. When I was in Metallica, I had brought this riff to them that I had invented, and nobody had ever seen this before. It was called Spider Riff. Stuff like that, because it's so much easier instead of going, because you're taking your fingers off the one string and going to the other string. There's going to be string noise, also the timing. Basically, my style is I play a lot of pentatonic stuff. I guess that's what it's called. Just that old blues style, because that's basically what I learned. I think that's part of a pentatonic scale. And then that's basically all those scales are. If I did it really slow up here. And then I do this weird thing where I kind of bar with my little finger and I go.